Before I open the floor for the questions, I invite our first discussant, Professor Manindra Thakur, for his comments. Thank you.
Since I went through both the papers, I must thank Savita ji and to both the professors. I think it's interesting to see that some of the people who are not culturally rooted in this society is trying to take these things more seriously than what we have been doing till now. Very recently, one of my papers has been passed by Board of Studies called Classical Indian Intellectual Traditions. And I know how much struggle I had to do to get the paper passed. Let me first talk about the first paper, and then I would like to comment about the second paper also, despite the fact that I am not a professionally trained psychoanalyst. But since I have been reading Sudhir Kakkar very carefully, and very recently me and Arvind have decided to design a course for ourselves on psychoanalysis and do it in the next 6 months. I think the first paper, the first presentation was fascinating in the sense the range of things that you mentioned, that you have been doing, is really quite impressive. And you and your students are taking up many things. But few things that attracted me from your presentation first, then I'll come to your paper. One is that that the Indian philosophical tradition is changing. This is something I think first time I'm hearing, and it seems to be quite convincing to me. I've been arguing that the approaches to Indian intellectual traditions or Indian philosophy till now have been guided by mostly a very, very structured power discourse. Most of the philosophy texts, if you read today, 10 years back, the philosophy text would talk about the Western philosophy, but call it philosophy in general. Since last 10 years, we find books are now also having at least one chapter each on India and China, and then the rest is Europe. If you look at the books by Asindas Gupta on history of Indian philosophy, or Sarkar on Mimamsa, or any text written during colonial period and early post-colonial period, you can easily see that there is a master-slave relationship that we are suffering from. That is, we are trying to do two things. One, we are trying to convince the West that, well, you have a philosophy, we too have a philosophy. We are not really lagging behind, we too have something to say. And at best, there is some movement, the second stage. Then we are saying, no, there could be something called comparative philosophy. So you have J.N. Mohanty and others doing comparative philosophy. There are few others, now they are saying, there is a possibility of hermeneutic dialogue between two traditions. So that's where we have reached till now. And I remember one of my gurus, Roy Bhasker, I don't know if you know this name, he's a philosopher of science. It's a very interesting episode, let me share that with you. When he came to India, I was looking for him in the hotel he was staying. And I was told that there's nobody called Roy Bhasker there, but there's somebody called Ram Roy Bhasker. So I said, maybe let me take a chance, let me connect with him. So the phone was connected, then I discovered that it was actually Roy Bhasker. So I asked him that, why are you Ram Roy Bhasker in India? He said, you know, my name was having Ram in the beginning, then I had to drop that in England. He was a son of an Indian father and an Irish mother. The father migrated to England in 1940s. So that kind of wounded psyche he was carrying, and the culmination of that was that he wrote around 10 books. His 10th book was on, it's called Odyssey of Soul, from east to west, philosophy from east to west. And in that, he used a lot of concepts and categories without translating. For instance, he used Maya without translating. And just after that, I had a chance to attend a conference, which was a conference based on his philosophy, which is called critical realism. So critical realism is a famous school of thought now. It's interdisciplinary philosophical school. And in that particular conference, which was organized just after the book came actually, he was not invited. So I was wondering, why was he not invited? Then somebody told me, no, he is having a religious turn. I said, how do you explain that? A famous sociologist from Warwick University, she said, no, he's using these concepts without translating them, and this seems to be he's getting influenced by Indian religion and all. I asked him that, what is your opinion? When I came back to India, fortunately he also came here after some time. He said, look, my problem is, I'm telling them that if you are agreeing with my 9 books, then my 10th book is the logical culmination of my 9 books. So you can't deny the 10th book at all. Till 9 books, I kept hiding all my philosophical concepts and kept using all the categories that you have been using, but now you can't do it anymore. So that's one story. And of course, the other story about Carl Jung, who, when he came to India and wrote a lot of articles about Indian theories of consciousness, and there's a book now published called Jung in East. And towards the end, he was told by psychoanalytic community that you must withdraw all such writings. Otherwise, you would be excommunicated from psychoanalytic community. And he withdrew, fortunately. He said that, well, all those writings were my infatuation with Indian tradition and other culture. It's only at the age of 62, when he was not well, he was critically ill, and he had a dream, and in that dream he found somebody in white clad sitting in yoga asana, and telling him that you can't die at the moment, you have to do a lot of work. And then he, after that dream, he became all right after some time, and then he took a U-turn, and he started writing about Indian tradition, taking it more seriously. And you must knowing that his one of the books, which I think is the most important book, called Red Book, was not published in his lifetime, and was not published quite for some time. It was published only a few years back, 6 years back, I think this Red Book is published now, and which I think is the most significant book that he has written. So there is a problem with approaching Indian intellectual tradition, and this problem is kind of Orientalism, which we also suffer from. Why I'm saying this, because I think that both these papers have really defied that kind of approach to Indian intellectual tradition, and I think what I call this is a kind of democratic negotiation with intellectual tradition, with an intellectual tradition, where you are engaging with other tradition as a genuine possible tradition. Maybe things like guru-sister relationship, or things like the transcendental capacities of a person may not be culturally acceptable to the culture where you belong to, from which you belong to, but yet you are saying that there is a possibility, and let's explore that. So this gives me an impression that this is a kind of approach which is quite interesting and impressive. And in the first paper, I think and Hinduism, at that stage probably Mimamsa started denying, as you are also saying that. What was there in the period when this struggle did not start? Because even with Nyaya, we can see, once there is a struggle between Nyaya and Buddhist, there is a problem of this kind coming, that a lot of categories and concepts which were not earlier in Nyaya started getting in. For instance, the idea of the Ishwar was not there in Nyaya to begin with. The Gautam Nyaya Sutra doesn't believe in God. It doesn't have any idea of Ishwar. But later on, the idea of Ishwar particularly after Buddhist debate, it started gradually pouring in, and in the 12th century, it became one of the prominent issues that whether God exists or not. So is it that in the history of Indian philosophy, there are moments when, due to political reasons, certain concepts and categories are interpolated? That's one thing one has to examine that, since I'm not an expert on either Mimamsa or this. But the other thing, that this yogi pratyaksha, I was just talking to Dr. Manibhushan before coming, that how do you think of the yogi pratyaksha? So a commonsensical understanding of any of the Indian would be that, well, this is possible. Yogi pratyaksha is possible. Yogi pratyaksha would mean that somebody who is a yogi has a capacity to become what is called Trikaldarshi. Trikaldarshi is one who knows the past, present and future, who can see the past, present and future. And the Panini, as Patanjali Yoga Sutra talks about it, that if you meditate and if you achieve certain layers of consciousness, at that time you develop this capacity to see beyond the limited horizons. I was talking to a tantric in Mayong. Mayong is a place in Assam where I'm doing field work these days. It's a very interesting place, which is a tantric learning center, and which used to be a world center of tantric learning in 9th century, because Muslims from Middle East, Middle Asia used to come here also, Central Asia and used to come here also. So this place, the person told me a very interesting thing. I asked him, he's an educated person. I asked him that, as an educated person, do you believe in this tantricism? He said that, look, let me give you an argument. And you try to refute that argument. That you can see certain things by your eyes. You try to see some more minute things through microscope. There could be something more which even microscope can't see. But human body has the capacity to develop its tools, which is not the physical tool, but maybe the mental tool, to engage with those things which are not visible otherwise. And that is possible if we meditate or do some kind of sadhana. And then we control those things. And then we can use those things. So probably that requires a lot of hard work, but it is a possibility. You can't deny the possibility that there could be certain elements in nature which is not visible otherwise, but human beings may engage with that. Now, while teaching Quran recently, I discovered a very interesting thing, and I must share that with you. There's a physicist called Kaku, a Japanese physicist, and there's a YouTube video you can see easily, who talks about multiple multiverses, simultaneously existing. And now they are saying that there's some instrument that they have developed which can get the magnetic field of something existing around us, hovering on this universe. They have not been able to really catch that, but the analogy that he gives is that, imagine a fish scientist. What the fish scientist would be thinking about human beings? No idea of three-dimensional being, but they must be imagining something. So there are multiple universes existing simultaneously. So when Quran is saying that there's a jinnat, we don't have any evidence, but we can't also deny the possibility. There could be certain creatures around which we don't know, and maybe tomorrow we develop certain kind of tools through which we can see these things. At the moment we are not seeing. So supernatural power of human beings, what we call supernatural, looks to be a possibility. Looks to be a possibility. And if this possibility comes from the complexity of the body, that is a very interesting thing to understand. And since I'm working on this knowledge and practice in India and trying to interact with some people like this, there used to be a person called Baba Neeb Karoli. And you can see the videos and all. Now, I'm not into Babas definitely, but there's an ashram nearby. And the person came to me, who is running the ashram now. He said that, you see, Baba Neeb Karoli had one wish, and he has given this responsibility to me, that you should create a university which can teach what you call this mystic knowledge. Because this mystic knowledge is not actually mystic knowledge, this is knowledge. This is very scientific knowledge. Our problem is that we don't understand that. The problem is that modern scientific epistemology doesn't have the capacity to understand that. And about him, there are a lot of controversies, a lot of stories. But the recent story is that, which may fascinate you, that the ex-Apple chief, what is his name? Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs was his disciple, and he actually transformed himself after meeting Baba Neeb Karoli. This is acknowledged by Steve Jobs in his autobiography. And Julia Roberts recently converted to Hinduism, saying that by looking at the photograph of this Baba, I am converting to Hinduism. So I don't know what it is, but there seems to be something somewhere. And there's somebody called Ramdas, who was a mathematician teaching in Harvard, who became his disciple, and now he stays in the Kanchi ashram. What I'm suggesting is that what we call supernatural, we call them supernatural, or we call them Kala Jadu, black magic, maybe because the knowledge epistemology that we have got with the modern science, we limit our imagination within that. And this is also possible because we have the way we have Cartesian dualism, which has actually fixed that epistemology with the mind-body duality, cannot comprehend this kind of complexity of the mind which tantric philosophy tries to give. So this idea of supernatural power and yogi pratyaksh doesn't seem to be very unnatural to any Indian who has some kind of interaction with the Indian culture. We have encountered a lot of such people who have such kind of things. But I'm wondering that, and the point that you have made, and which is a very powerful point, beyond this idea, that how this idea has been attacked or appreciated in the history of philosophy at different moments, within different traditions, is there any relationship between, and that's my query, is there any relationship between the politics of knowledge and this kind of response to this idea? That would be one. Second is about the revealed knowledge. I think this Cartesian dualism also sidelined the idea of revealed knowledge. And probably the measure that it used was the possibility of transfer of knowledge. And knowledge has to be publicly acknowledged. So it has to be publicly shareable. And therefore, whenever we debate about any mystic or anything, normal response is that, can he show that in the lab? Can he perform that in front of me? Have you seen that with your eyes? These are the normal debates that we do. I think the possibility of revealed knowledge is very much there if we try to engage with the idea of human nature in Indian tradition. And it is beyond any philosophical tradition. It is what you said. Is there something within us without any mediation of any intellectual tradition? psychoanalysis or anything. Is there something within us that repeatedly can give or can make anybody capable of accessing that? Can we, is that something there? I think that there's a concept of aparushaya gyan means something which is not dependent on us, the knowledge which is not dependent on us. So any knowledge which is objective knowledge, objective about the nature, objective about the self also, which can be shared, which can be, see, there is a concept that there are certain kind of knowledge which can re-emerge again and again, despite the fact that all shastras about that are burnt. But they are integral to us, they are eternal to us, and therefore we can access that. And that may question the idea of intellectual property right, but that's a possibility. And that probably, that kind of knowledge can be acquired by what you call the revealed tradition. And therefore, if you attend a Vipassana, the Buddhist meditation technique, what they do is they constantly take you to that level of consciousness where they say that what you have to realize is the most essential part of your existence. And if you experience that essential part of existence, that is that everything that comes goes, there's a rhythm, there's a wave. So if you experience that wave, that is what is the core idea of the universe. And if you catch that core idea of the universe, from there you can theorize the rest of the things. So anybody can do it. I'm sure if there's a politics of knowledge, the Mimamsaks would deny that, because Mimamsaks would say that, well, this is something that will defy the Vedic tradition. But defying Vedic tradition is not abnormal, not very unnatural. People have done that. I mean, we know about Ashtavakra, who was son of Uddalak, who was a Vedic rishi, and he himself said that I defy the Vedic knowledge completely. And there is a debate between Janak and Ashtavakra, which is called Ashtavakra Gita, which is about this essential eternal aspect of human beings, from where knowledge can spontaneously emerge. Sorry, it's getting too long. I'll not get into it anymore. So these are issues in this first topic. In the second paper, I think it's a very complex relationship. I'm thankful to you that you have really taken it up. One slope that we used to pronounce before dinner in our schools, and that very late I revealed that it was about the Guru-Shishya relationship. It's called, I mean, many people must be remembering, Om Sahano Bhavatu Sahano Bhunaktu Sahviryam Karvavahe, something. I did not know what would it mean. It actually means, you know what does it mean? Guru and Shish, both together, they are saying that God protect us both, God nourish us both, may we live together, work together, give us energy to do that without fighting among ourselves, without any hostility. So it seems that the relationship is very difficult, very complex relationship. On the one hand, yes, it is a relationship of surrender, and probably there is a therapeutic element in that also, as you have explained, that it's entirely possible that if I have starved for some kind of relationship with my parents or somebody, we may kind of project that relationship there, and we become emotionally dependent on the teacher. I mean, as a teacher in India, probably we have all experienced that. When I was told first time that I'm not a teacher, I'm an instructor, I was very angry. I thought I must resign. Because we always conceive ourselves, most of us, that we are teachers, and therefore with the students the relationship is very different. It is not the relation of an instructor. So we do enter into multiple relationships with these people. And at times it is, and particularly in the setting of third world where your students are suffering from a lot of problems, you do engage in different kind of relationships. At times you are, they become emotionally dependent on you, so much so that you start fearing that emotional dependence. But probably that emotional dependence for some time becomes very liberative to the other person. That also changes. And what I have experienced in our course of time, by the way, we organize an annual conference called Creative Theory Colloquium on 5th and 6th September, just because it is Teacher's Day. So you can understand this, we are into this teacher-taught relationship. The Guru Shishya Parampara, we do follow that. But I think it's also changing. So it's a very complex relationship that keeps changing as Indian philosophy keeps changing. The relationship also keeps changing. Whether psychoanalysis can capture it or not, particularly Freudian psychoanalysis can capture it or not, it is something to be understood. I think if we go by Jungian psychoanalysis, that explains this relationship much better than the Freudian psychoanalysis. And fortunately, I see Sudhir Kakkar changing into this direction. His earlier books were mostly Freudian psychoanalysis, and I must say that Indian psychoanalysis, though I don't know much, but I can say with some confidence, since I've read most of the books written by these psychoanalysts, that it's a copycat thing. There's hardly any creativity. It's a derivative discourse. There's hardly any creativity involved in that, except few who have started kind of deviating from there. So initial books of Sudhir Kakkar may look very fascinating, but were quite copycat. Recent writings, I was discussing with Arvind, like Ecstasy, seems to be quite creative. And there he's changing his positions, that I can see. I asked him though, he said, no, I have not changed my position, but it is very much visible. For instance, let me give you an example. There's an episode, there are two things in that. One, that most of the psychoanalysts, Ghosh particularly, that book called Vishnu on the Desk of Freud, says that the relation between Vivekanand and Ramakrishna Paramahansa was a kind of homosexual relationship. Kakkar has given a new interpretation to that in this Ecstasy. He says that, and I think he uses Sankhya philosophy to argue this. He says that this is the relationship beyond the notion of the body. It's not the body, it's not a sexual relationship, it's beyond the body. There is an example of this kind in that text, which is a famous story in Bengal, that in a temple where Ramakrishna was staying for some time and accepted the temple head as the guru, after some days, after some months, the guru committed suicide. And there was a rumor about this, that they were found in compromising position, sexually compromising position, and therefore guru committed suicide. Kakkar's explanation is very different. Kakkar says that both of them used to meditate in the room. They were staying in the same room. And one night, the guru used to have an idol of God, goddess, on his lap while meditating. So one night he discovered that idol has shifted from his lap to Vivekananda's and Hinduism. At that stage, probably Mimamsa started denying, as you are also saying that. What was there in the period when this struggle did not start? Because even with Nyay, we can see, once there's a struggle between Nyay and Buddhist, there's a problem of this kind coming, that a lot of categories and concepts which were not earlier in Nyay started getting in. For instance, the idea of the Ishwar was not there in Nyay to begin with. The Gautam Nyay Sutra doesn't believe in God. It doesn't have any idea of Ishwar. But later on, the idea of Ishwar particularly after the Buddhist debate, it started gradually pouring in, and in the 12th century, it became one of the prominent issues that whether God exists or not. So is it that in the history of Indian philosophy, there are moments when, due to political reasons, certain concepts and categories are interpolated. That's one thing one has to examine that, since I'm not an expert on either Mimamsa or this. But the other thing that this yogi pratyaksha, I was just talking to Dr. Manibhushan before coming, that how do you think of the yogi pratyaksha? So a commonsensical understanding of any of the Indian would be that, well, this is possible. Yogi pratyaksha is possible. Yogi pratyaksha would mean that somebody who is a yogi has a capacity to become what is called Trikaldarshi. Trikaldarshi is one who knows the past, present and future, who can see the past, present and future. And the Panini, as Patanjali Yoga Sutra talks about it, that if you meditate and if you achieve certain layers of consciousness, at that time you develop this capacity to see beyond the limited horizons. I was talking to a tantric in Mayong. Mayong is a place in Assam where I'm doing field work these days. It's a very interesting place, which is a tantric learning center, and which used to be a world center of tantric learning in 9th century, because Muslims from Middle East, Middle Asia used to come here also, Central Asia and used to come here also. So. This place, the person told me a very interesting thing. I asked him, he's an educated person. I asked him that, as an educated person, do you believe in this tantricism? He said that, look, let me give you an argument. And you try to refute that argument. That you can see certain things by your eyes. You try to see some more minute things through microscope. There could be something more which even microscope can't see. But human body has the capacity to develop its tools, which is not the physical tool, but maybe the mental tool, to engage with those things which are not visible otherwise. And that is possible if we meditate or do some kind of sadhana. And then we control those things. And then we can use those things. So probably that requires a lot of hard work, but it is a possibility. You can't deny the possibility that there could be certain elements in nature which is not visible otherwise, but human beings may engage with that. Now, while teaching Quran recently, I discovered a very interesting thing, and I must share that with you. There's a physicist called Kaku, a Japanese physicist, and there's a YouTube video you can see easily, who talks about multiple multiverses, simultaneously existing. And now they are saying that there's some instrument that they have developed which can get the magnetic field of something existing around us, hovering on this universe. They have not been able to really catch that, but the analogy that he gives is that, imagine a fish scientist. What the fish scientist would be thinking about human beings. No idea of three-dimensional being, but they must be imagining something. So there are multiple universes existing simultaneously. So when Quran is saying that there's a jinnat, we don't have any evidence, but we can't also deny the possibility. There could be certain creatures around which we don't know, and maybe tomorrow we develop certain kind of tools through which we can see these things. At the moment, we are not seeing. So supernatural power of human beings, what we call supernatural, looks to be a possibility. Looks to be a possibility. And if this possibility comes from the complexity of the body, that is a very interesting thing to understand. And since I'm working on this knowledge and practice in India, I'm trying to interact with some people like this. There used to be a person called Baba Neeb Karoli, and you can see the videos and all. Now, I'm not into Babas definitely, but there's an ashram nearby. And the person came to me, who is running the ashram now. He said that, you see, Baba Neep Karoli had one wish, and he has given this responsibility to me, that you should create a university which can teach what you call this mystic knowledge. Because this mystic knowledge is not actually mystic knowledge, this is knowledge. This is very scientific knowledge. Our problem is that we don't understand that. The problem is that modern scientific epistemology doesn't have the capacity to understand that. And about him, there are a lot of controversies, a lot of stories. But the recent story is that, which may fascinate you, that the Apple, ex-Apple chief, what is his name? Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs was his disciple, and he actually got, he transformed himself after meeting Baba Neep Karoli. This is acknowledged by Steve Jobs in his autobiography. And Julia Roberts recently converted to Hinduism, saying that by looking at the photograph of this Baba, I'm converting to Hinduism. So I don't know what it is, but there seems to be something somewhere. And there's somebody called Ramdas, who was a mathematician teaching in Harvard, who became his disciple, and now he stays in the Kanchi ashram. What I'm suggesting is that what we call supernatural, we call them supernatural, or we call them Kala Jadu, black magic, maybe because the knowledge epistemology that we have got with the modern science, we limit our imagination within that. And this is also possible because we have the way we have Cartesian dualism, which has actually fixed that epistemology with the mind-body duality, cannot comprehend this kind of complexity of the mind which tantric philosophy tries to give. So this idea of supernatural power and yogi pratyaksh doesn't seem to be very unnatural to any Indian who has some kind of interaction with the Indian culture. We have encountered a lot of such people who have such kind of things. But I'm wondering that, and the point that you have made, and which is a very powerful point, beyond this idea, that how this idea has been attacked or appreciated in the history of philosophy at different moments within different traditions, is there any relationship between, and that's my query, is there any relationship between the politics of knowledge and this kind of response to this idea? That would be one. Second is about the revealed knowledge. I think this Cartesian dualism also sidelined the idea of revealed knowledge. Probably the measure that it used was the transfer of, the possibility of transfer of knowledge. And knowledge has to be publicly acknowledged. So it has to be publicly shareable. And therefore, whenever we debate about any mystic or anything, normal response is that, can he show that in the lab? Can he perform that in front of me? Have you seen that with your eyes? These are the normal debates that we do. I think the possibility of revealed knowledge is very much there if we try to engage with the idea of human nature in Indian tradition. And it is beyond any philosophical tradition. It is what you said. Is there something within us without any mediation of any intellectual tradition, psychoanalysis or anything? Is there something within us that repeatedly can give or can make anybody capable of accessing that? Can we, is that something there? I think that there's a concept of aparushaya gyan means something which is not dependent on us, the knowledge which is not dependent on us. So any knowledge which is objective knowledge, objective about the nature, objective about the self also, which can be shared, which can be, see, there is a concept that there are certain kind of knowledge which can re-emerge again and again, despite the fact that all shastras about that are burnt. But they are integral to us, they are eternal to us, and therefore we can access that. And that may question the idea of intellectual property right, but that's a possibility. And that probably, that kind of knowledge can be acquired by what you call the revealed tradition. And therefore, if you attend Vipassana, the Buddhist meditation technique, what they do is they constantly take you to that level of consciousness where they say that what you have to realize is the most essential part of your existence. And if you experience that essential part of existence, that is, that everything that comes goes, there's a rhythm, there's a wave. So if you experience that wave, that is what is the core idea of the universe. And if you catch that core idea of the universe, from there you can theorize the rest of the things. So anybody can do it. I'm sure if there's a politics of knowledge, the Mimamsaks would deny that, because Mimamsaks would say that, well, this is something that will defy the Vedic tradition. But defying Vedic tradition is not abnormal, not very unnatural. People have done that. I mean, we know about Ashtavakra, who was son of Uddalak, who was a Vedic rishi, and he himself said that I defy the Vedic knowledge completely. And there is a debate between Janak and Ashtavakra, which is called Ashtavakra Gita, which is about this essential eternal aspect of human beings, from where knowledge can spontaneously emerge. Sorry, it's getting too long. I'll not get into it anymore. So these are issues in this first topic. In the second paper, I think it's a very complex relationship. I'm thankful to you that you have really taken it up. One slope that we used to pronounce before dinner in our schools, and that very late I revealed that it was about the Guru-Shishya relationship. It's called, I mean, many people must be remembering, Om Sahano Bhavatu Sahano Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karvavahe, something. I did not know what it mean. It actually means, you know what does it mean? Guru and Shish, both together, they are saying that God protect us both, God nourish us both, may we live together, work together, give us energy to do that without fighting among ourselves, without any hostility. So it seems that the relationship is very difficult, very complex relationship. On the one hand, yes, it is a relationship of surrender. And probably there is a therapeutic element in that also, as you have explained, that it's entirely possible that if I have starved for my some kind of relationship with my parents or somebody, we may kind of project that relationship there. And we become emotionally dependent on the teacher. I mean, as a teacher in India, probably we have all experienced that. When I was told first time that I'm not a teacher, I'm an instructor, I was very angry. I thought I must resign. Because we always conceive ourselves, most of us, that we are teachers, and therefore with the students the relationship is very different. It is not the relation of an instructor. So we do enter into multiple relationships with these people. And at times it is, and particularly in the setting of third world, where your students are suffering from lot of problems, you do engage in different kind of relationships. At times you are, they become emotionally dependent on you, so much so that you start fearing that emotional dependence. But probably that emotional dependence for some time becomes very liberative to the other person. That also changes. And what I have experienced in our course of time, by the way, we organize an annual conference called Creative Theory Colloquium on 5th and 6th September, just because it is Teacher's Day. So you can understand this, we are into this teacher-taught relationship, the Guru-Shishya Parampara, we do follow that. But I think it's also changing. So it's a very complex relationship that keeps changing as Indian philosophy keeps changing. The relationship also keeps changing. Whether psychoanalysis can capture it or not, particularly Freudian psychoanalysis can capture it or not, it is something to be understood. I think if we go by Jungian psychoanalysis, that explains this relationship much better than the Freudian psychoanalysis. And fortunately, I see Sudhir Kakkar changing into this direction. His earlier books were mostly Freudian psychoanalysis. And I must say that Indian psychoanalysis, though I don't know much, but I can say with some confidence, since I've read most of the books written by these psychoanalysts, that it's a copycat thing. There's hardly any creativity. It's a derivative discourse. There's hardly any creativity involved in that, except few who have started kind of deviating from there. So initial books of Sudhir Kakkar may look very fascinating, but were quite copycat. Recent writings, I was discussing with Arvind, like Ecstasy, seems to be quite creative. And there he's changing his positions, that I can see. I asked him though, he said, no, I have not changed my position, but it is very much visible. For instance, let me give you an example. There is an episode, there are two things in that. One, that most of the psychoanalysts, Ghosh particularly, that book called Vishnu on the Desk of Freud, says that the relation between Vivekananda and Ramakrishna Paramahans was a kind of homosexual relationship. Kakkar has given a new interpretation to that in this Ecstasy. He says that, and I think he uses Sankhya philosophy to argue this. He says that this is the relationship beyond the notion of the body. It's not the body, it's not a sexual relationship, it's beyond the body. There is an example of this kind in that text, which is a famous story in Bengal, that in a temple where Ramakrishna was staying for some time and accepted the temple head as the guru, after some days, after some months, the guru committed suicide. And there was a rumor about this, that they were found in compromising position, sexually compromising position, and therefore guru committed suicide. Kakkar's explanation is very different. Kakkar says that both of them used to meditate in the room. They were staying in the same room. And one night, the guru used to have an idol of goddess on his lap while meditating. So one night he discovered that idol has shifted from his lap to Ramakrishna's lap. So he was surprised. It happened thrice. Then he thought that I have been meditating so long, but this young man has the capacity to meditate much more than me. So my possibility of liberation is very less, and therefore I have no right to live. That is Kakkar's explanation. I do not know whether this is true or not, but this shows a shift in Kakkar's understanding of this relationship. And this shift, to me, is a Jungian shift. By the way, I was attending Kakkar's one of the seminars on Tagore's eyes, where he was arguing that Tagore's eyes in paintings, are eyes of his sister-in-law with whom he had a relationship. And in that hall, there were two rows of scholars sitting. The right side were Freudians and left side were Jungians. And I could see the fight between Jungians and Freudians on that particular issue. So it looks like as if Probably Jungian analysis will give us much more depth understanding of this kind of relationship, where what you are saying, the relationship is not of idolatry, but of creative identification. That when you identify with somebody, it doesn't mean that you completely get out of your identity, but what you do is you merge yourself and you separate yourself, and in that process you draw the energy. And Guru is also conscious of it, that he's allowing his energy to flow to you, because he thinks that you are the one who is what is called Manas Putra, that you are my son, the son who would inherit my intellectual tradition. So probably that is a kind of a relationship that can be explained. And that definitely is a very, very creative relationship. And in some way or other, a lot of us have experienced that relationship where the guru is troubled. He suffers in order to transfer knowledge to you. At times you are not interested in getting that knowledge, but the guru is really troubled to, somehow he or she wants to transfer that to you so that you can carry that forward. And the knowledge is more important than your body, than you yourself, than one's identity. So what is at stake is the continuity in the intellectual tradition. I think that is something that one can see. Thank you very much for both papers.